Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. So in this session, we're going to talk about API integration. So it's interesting because we talked about mostly microservices and mostly from a provider standpoint. And in this talk, I'm going to talk about the other side of the mirror, mostly about third-party API and from the consumer standpoint. So first, so I'm Guillaume. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Bearer. We're basically building a developer tool to build and manage API integration. And prior to that, I've been CTO and VP engineering for over 10 years at VodiClick and a company called Skillsoft in the US, where basically we've seen the rise of API starting like 10 years ago from a SaaS standpoint. We're building an HR tech product. We've seen integration in that world as being a nice to have and a good selling point actually to sell the solution in Fortune 500 customers, because they were a bit tired to actually buy a lot of different SaaS products and not having them integrating between each other. And then by 2015, 2016, we realized it was not anymore a nice to have. It was actually a must have. As being a SaaS provider today, you actually need to actually build those integrations. Otherwise, you're not going to sell. And it's even more the truth of when you actually sell to a higher end kind of customer. And based on all that experience, we reflected and took a good look at the opportunity behind API integration by building more integrations today and why we do that, but also the pains. Because the pain about building API integration is actually pretty big and mostly on the engineering organization. It's half the time the need comes from business and product, but the engineering organization is mostly a bottleneck today. And the question is why, and this is what we've actually asked the industry and actually taken a good look to kind of start to write on the playbook on something that doesn't really much exist. So first, pretty simple, just the definition. What is an API integration? This is a bit barbaric, API integration, and a lot of people are actually thinking about different things when they talk about API integration. So it's pretty basic. It's just about making sure that we can interface software between each other. That's really basic, and that's why it means multiple things at the same time. And what I'm going to talk about is actually a bit more precise about native API integration. We've seen that word pop up lately because we've seen also a lot of low-code or no-code solution out there that talks about API integration. And when we talk about native API integration, we're really talking about how you're going to be able to connect third-party APIs into your stack, into your software. So this is where you actually need your engineering team to work on. And you can build, obviously, a bit different things than with low-code or no-code solutions. So APIs, it's a tale of two worlds. And I think as an industry, we've been focusing on one end for quite a long time, on the provider. Now we kind of know how to build an API. We've been thinking about documenting, testing, it's right, it's not over. It's changing all the time. We've been building a lot of solutions to help. It's great. And now you've got that. Well, you build an API, it's awesome. But if you build that API, it's to have people actually using it and integrating with. And so on the other side of the mirror, you've got developers, basically the same one in a different context. They would like to, but, and there is always a but. And if you ask, and if your product team or your sales organization is asking for integration, the but always comes from the engineering team, because it's not that simple. So we wanted to first understand actually who builds integration today. We interviewed actually way more than 48 companies now. Those slides are actually 3 or 4 months old. We did interview companies across the board from seed stage company starting right now building a product up to IPO and enterprise. And what we've taken a good look at all those different kind of personas and ask basic question. The first one is, do you consume third-party APIs? It's not really much of a surprise, but the majority of the answer is yes, obviously. The only two that actually said no are open source vendor, which you can understand quite easily why they don't consume third-party APIs, which is a distribution problem for them. Then we ask, but what? Why? What do you do with those third-party API? And at the end of the day, you can divide that into two different pieces. The first one is because you want to build your core product. And this is something that is rising, and we're going to talk a bit more about that. But today, you don't want to reinvent the wheel. So if you're looking for payment, you could Stripe, you're looking for search to Algolia, to Twilio for email, et cetera, et cetera. And there are more of those kind of API-first product coming out there, and you want to start to build your core product this way. And the other aspect of why you're going to consume third-party API is actually to add feature and create partnership. There is a saying nowadays that partnership. Well, integration is the new partnership. You see that every day from Intercom, from Twilio, etc., where all those companies are actually integrating with each other and they build partnership this way. And those two are actually pretty much combined. And this is the case with all the SaaS vendor and all the SaaS product that we're all using here, from SaaS, Salesforce to Slack to Google Drive, etc. And those actually integrate within each other, and everybody wants to integrate with them. So we asked to those companies who actually build their core product with third-party APIs. And obviously, the answer is yes. Everybody is actually doing that today. When you take a look at Twilio, Algolia, or Stripe, those are like 5-7 years old product. They're just being really, really big nowadays. And it's just the beginning of a wave. And it's going to continue. And about feature and building a partnership, well, that is a little bit more mixed. Not every company is actually out there think about API integration as a way to add features or build those partnerships. It's still a vast majority, but we've asked and taken a good look at those that says no, actually why, and who are they. And when we actually look at done what kind of companies says no, it's the majority that are actually seed stage company, and the answer is pretty obvious. Why don't they do that? Well, they don't yet have the product market fit, so they are not yet at the stage where they can actually invest resources and engineering resources into building partnership, adding feature. They are trying to figure out what's their product. So they are not yet at that stage. Obviously, there are some others, as you can see, from IPO stage or even Series A or Series B. Obviously, across the board, you're going to find a lot of different companies that don't actually think about integration as a way to build feature or partnership, but it's obviously reducing. That's basically all the different insights from a global point of view. And the result is, at the end of the day, we all eventually are going to build integration. There is no question of why or why we wouldn't do that. It's obvious, but it's just the beginning. I don't know if you've read that article a few weeks ago on TechCrunch, written by Axel, which basically says that APIs are the next big wave of SaaS, mainly because of API-first product. Those that I talked about, like Stripe, Algolia, etc., just the next wave, and they see that wave as actually being bigger than the previous SaaS one. Which is obvious because, like, we're building more and more software every day, and you don't want to actually have your engineering team spend resources on reinventing the wheel. If you can actually go faster and build your core business because you're using other people's technology, it's actually getting better. But it's not that simple, because if it was that simple, we wouldn't be here, I imagine. And we asked, what's your pain? Why is that so complex to actually build all those integration? And we've actually heard a lot of things. The first one is the diversity of APIs. When you're building third-party integration with third-party APIs, you're consuming a bunch of APIs. They're all working differently. They all have a different technology behind the scene. They all have different protocol, different format. And maybe nowadays you do have like GraphQL API, it's awesome, but you're still going to have to rely on SOAP API also for some part. And that diversity is actually hurting you in that strategy. The feature disparity, because, well, some APIs do provide an SDK, some don't. Maybe not in your core languages. You may have webhooks or not. You may have another kind of event-driven system or not. Authentication is actually a huge pain across developers when you ask about auth. I think we can all agree as an industry that auth actually pushed things in the right direction. But auth is actually such a pain for developers. They don't understand how it works. They don't understand how to secure it, how to actually manage to get those tokens, those refresh tokens, and so on. And the implementation of auth are actually awful. Like, if you take a look at probably 20 of the top SaaS API out there, take a good look at their auth implementation, they are not the same. They are not at all the same. People are not actually fully respecting the protocol because it's not really a standard behind the scene. That's one of the issues. The use cases are a big issue also. Like, when you think about building a third-party integration, well, to add features, like, but what can I do with that API? Does that API provide everything needed? And that's usually a discussion between product and between engineering, and that ping pong between those two is actually really hard to get going. And then once you see everything on the left is basically about building, then once you actually reach that, well, the question is it going to work? And what you tend to see is, like, well, API break all the time for a lot of different reasons. And that's the first pain point that usually you hear from your SRE or slash DevOps team. You lack proper monitoring. Usually those third parties API that live in your stack are like a dark corner. You don't really want to touch it. You don't really know what's going on under the hood. In terms of security, credentials are usually a big question. How do you manage those? Usually you know how to manage credentials nowadays, but with your third-party APIs, it's usually tricky. There is no real ownership behind that. I'm not even talking about rotation of those credentials. Technical debt is what most of the people in the industry that scaled API integration with like 20, 30, 40 different kind of integration, mostly when they built integration marketplace. I'm not going to say any name of SaaS provider, but you probably have some ideas in mind. Well, their issues is most of the time they build tons of technical debt. And that's security issue, that's dependencies that they need to manage. And at the end, it's also data leak, because an API is just a way to get data out of your stack. Do you know which data do you send to which provider? Does anyone have any oversight about that? Those are all the kind of questions and the pain points that as an industry and as an engineering organization are seeing API integration. So API integration, we might be in 2019, but API integration is still a pain, and it's still a huge pain to actually build. Do you have the feedback? Oh, yep. So we tried to condense all of that in kind of a playbook. So what basically, there are four pillars to API integration management. The theme of the talk is what it takes to build. But actually, building is just one part of the overall equation. So yes, it always starts by building, taking a look at an API and trying to build an integration and something meaningful. But if you build, the first thing that you need to actually try to tackle is the monitoring. You want to know what's happening behind the scene. You want to be able to see if it works, if it doesn't work, and go, obviously, a little bit beyond. Once you monitor, you're able to think a little bit more about security. Security about your credentials, security about the kind of data that goes through the wire. And also, if you monitor, you're going to be able to think about how you're going to optimize. That's that next thing. And security and optimization about your API integration are two things that you're going to be able to get back at the building time, and you're going to be able to really improve your integration, and maybe the next one you're going to build are going to be better, are going to be more robust. One of the issues also that we see in the industry is like once you build an API integration, like nobody wants to touch it. Nobody wants to improve it. Nobody wants to actually change it and use the latest version of the API that the provider is actually getting out there. So that's one of the issue with technical debt. And if we take a look in each of those different buckets at building, what it really means at the end of the day. So the first part and the first decision usually that is made and that is a non-spoken decision most of the time is about API client or SDK usage. You're going to use an API. Most of the time, you're going to find a client or an SDK. I'm not going to talk about the difference between those two, but let's say the same. So the first question is, there is one. I do have a Python stack or a Go stack. Am I going to be able to find an API client? Actually, why would I use it? That's the first question that you should ask yourself, but most people don't ask that question. And if there is one, what's the impact on your stack for today and for the future? Are you going to build 30 API integration, and are you going to embed 30 different SDK or API clients coming from 30 different providers, where most of those are unmaintained or open source, and you don't know if they are really maintained at the end of the day? So are you going to do that? And sadly, most of the time, it's an unspoken decision. It's made by the developer himself. You think you're going to gain some time by doing that, because it's always a question of time and cost, but you may not. What's the feature set that you're going to get from those API clients? Because it's nice to have a nice wrapper of a REST call or GraphQL, whatever. Does it deal with network retry? Does it deal with request identifier? Does it deal with timeout configuration? All those kind of things. And obviously, they are not going to be the same across all the different clients that you're going to use. So that's the first thing. Then you need to work with authentication, and I'm putting a strong emphasis on the OAuth here. Because OAuth, once again, this is the biggest pain point that we've heard from developers. What kind of version of OAuth is the provider supporting? Is it OAuth 1, 1A, 2? etc. What kind of grant type? Is there refresh tokens involved? How do you get those refresh tokens? How do you trigger the auth dance? How are you going to revoke those tokens? I need to change the scopes. What's the impact of the user that I already have tokens from them? How am I going to have to ask them to re-authenticate again, etc., etc., etc. All of those questions that maybe doable and manageable when you're consuming one or two or three APIs, but which is obviously unmanageable at scale. Then it's about using webhooks, because webhooks, well, today, if you think about the kind of an event-driven system, webhooks is usually the norm in third-party APIs when they do exist, obviously. They don't exist all the time. And if they do exist, well, that's the first question. But do they provide a retry mechanism? Do you get logs? Do you know if the webhook has been fired or not? Do you get some kind of signature to validate the origin? And if we think APIs are very diverse between different providers and not always amazing, when if you take a look at webhooks, usually you just want to open the window and jump because it's a nightmare. But this is what we have, so we tend to try to use it. Those are the kind of questions that you have to ask and the kind of things that you need to deal with when you start to build those API integration. And again, you do that with every different API. Then, well, we want to monitor because, well, we want to go a little bit past the point of what I'm building. And the first question is, why am I going to monitor those API that I'm using? Well, it's not my API, they should work. Well, sadly, they don't work all the time. Those are just a few examples that have been taken for the past month and took me like 5 minutes to compile. You've got Stripe. Stripe has issues with error rate or latency issues. It's like they do actually have multiple every week. Considering their scale, it's not normal, I think. Take a look at Google. Their OAuth2 endpoint have been dramatically failing like for 2 hours not long ago. You see on the Ruby community, there is a gem that is used by most API clients and most open source clients, which is called REST client. That gem has been hijacked, basically. And it has taken some time to have people realize that it hasn't been hijacked. So everybody using that gem actually could have every of their traffic hijacked and sent to another location. And an interesting one, and I really like this one, I don't know if you know Jason Lemkin, which is kind of the Pope of SaaS. This is a sales guy. This is not a tech guy at all, but even him gets that. If you're building API integration, well, this is your responsibility to make sure that it's going to work. Maybe the provider in front of you is not going to respond. Maybe they're going to have a network issue, whatever. It's your responsibility to actually make sure that it's going to work, even more if your application is mission critical. And as we go, APIs tend to be more mission critical, and those integration, obviously. So what it takes and what it means to build to monitor those API integration. So the first thing is actually gather metrics. And one of the first questions that you have to ask is, do you know which APIs you're using? And that is one of the basic questions we ask to all the people in the industry, and they don't have that answer right away. And ask that question yourself. Do you know exactly right now how many APIs and which API you're using in your stack? And the chances that you don't know are really big. So that's the first thing that you should know. Like I said, it's a dark corner usually in your stack. Then it's about monitoring. The first thing that you need to monitor is their latency, obviously, their error rate, your number of requests per minute, for instance, that you're doing on those APIs. So you're going to be able to track that over time. Then it's about producing logs. Your application, I don't know, like since at least 10 years, I guess, as engineers now, we think about monitoring, we think about logging, we've got amazing solution out there. We don't think that we're going to put an application in production without some kind of monitoring and in-depth logging where we're going to be able to analyze what's going on behind the hood. Well, with third-party API, well, usually you don't have any logging. And that goes back to the previous point when you build. If you use a third-party API client, chances that you're not going to be able to log properly what's going on is actually pretty big because take a look at the best API client out there, maybe Slack, maybe the Node.js Slack API client. They put some heavy resources. You can activate logging, and the best you're going to get is one line that said, yeah, I call the Slack API. Cool. How are you going to be able to debug something after? Good luck, and you're not. So think about logging, and logging for third-party API should be about everything you're actually doing, like the kind of request, the kind of response, the headers you get, even the payload, etc. You should be able to get an entire view of all the time what's happening and what do you send and what do you get. Obviously, if you do that, you need to actually think about filtering some sensitive data because, well, we talk about that after on the security aspect, but you're actually sending some critical data. It's about setting up alerting because now you've got metrics, you know exactly what's happening behind the scene. So you could set up alerts, you could set up custom rules based on error rate, based on latency deviation, for instance, the certain type of error, refresh token issues, et cetera, because you need to know what's happening behind the scene. You can't wait for like a tweet from Stripe to actually know that it doesn't work. That's not viable. And it's about security. So security means multiple things. The storing of your credential, how do you make them outside of your code base? How do you make sure that you use different kind of credential per environment? This is the norm in engineering. This is not the norm in API integration world, sadly. How do you manage that visibility between all the stakeholders? Then it's about how you manage the rotation of those credentials. And managing rotation is mean like you need to be able to do that in one click. If you don't have that kind of system, you're never going to have credential rotation. Do that at least every 6 months. How many of you actually have credentials that have been there for like at least 2 years? I think I'm the first one guilty here, but this is the case with most of us because we don't have tracking, we don't have logtrail, but when, why it has been updated. And it's about preventing data leaks, again. Monitor what kind of data is sent through the wire. You're leaking PII, you're leaking tons of things, and your security teams don't even know about it because you don't have the proper monitoring, once again. So it always kind of start like that. And you can obviously set up those alerts. And last one, really quickly, on optimization, because optimization, it's about, well, first shielding your application from API failures, because yes, API fail all the time. Well, shield it. Some critical business API call you're making, well, you need to actually make them from a background processing way. Don't make a synchronous call. Make them async. But if you do that, you need to think about setting up the right retry logic based on the status code. Think about the correct circuit breaker pattern. Don't eat the API kind of stupidly and cross some rate limiting, which is another issue. Faking event-driven system. Webhooks are not always there. You're going to have to do polling. Polling is a bitch, honestly. There are tons of issues with that, but Delta, but retry also. It's about setting up caching. You do want to set up caching because it's a nice circuit breaker pattern for actually API that are done or that have huge latency can work sometime. It also helps for reducing API cost. And the last one is about performance, even more if you think about mobile, and if mobile clients are your kind of user, well, optimizing for API network call is actually pretty important. So that's my last slide. As APIs are becoming basically the building block of modern software, well, we just need to be able to rely on them. And to rely on them is going to be critical. And relying on them is making sure that we can build on top of them, but that it works at the end of the day. And because this is all we are for. Thank you.